practical. I want to be as practical as I can. Right now, I'm going to put this away and put something on this table. And then I'm going to show you how I share the gospel. Because later I'm going to talk about Luke 10. What Jesus have commanded us to in Luke 10, go out, find a person in peace, go to their house, eat and drink what they are served, and share the gospel. And the best way for me to share the gospel is over a coffee table. To sit down with a coffee table, and then I illustrate the gospel by the things that's on the table. And I believe this is so important, because if we want truly to see people saved, it's not just share 5 minutes message and get them to prayer. You need to show them what it's all about. So what I often do when I'm out on the street, when I found people who's open, I said, let's go to a cafe. Let's go down. Let's sit down so I can share the gospel with them. And then I do it the way I'm going to show you now. And afterward, they see it and they say, whoa. And then they repent. Then I baptize them in water or lay the hands on them and they receive the Holy Spirit and baptize them in water. And this is working because the word of God is the truth. So now I'm going to put a table ready for you and I'm going to show you how I'm going to share the gospel. Yeah, now I'm sitting down here and I'm going to show you how I share the gospel. And I'm going to do it the way I often do it. At the same time, I'm going to give you some good ideas and explain why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I want to say that we need to be better to help people to come into the fullness of Christ. Very often I go to people where in churches they just let things happen the way it happened. If God wants to baptize people in the Holy Spirit, it come one day. But it should not be like that. We should go out baptizing them. We should go out getting them to repent. We should go out help them to get baptized in water, baptize them. We should go out and help them until they receive the Holy Spirit. But very often we just let things happen the way it happened and think it's all up to God. But it's up to us. God have commanded us to do it. And often when I share the gospel, I use this example for non-Christian, and I can use it for a lot of things. But I use this example when I share the gospel to people. I say, imagine you and me are playing chess. If we are playing chess or another game, then I move, and then it's your turn, and then it's my turn, and then it's your turn, and then it's my turn, I do this. If I now do this, and I know exactly what I want to do next time, I want to move this. Am I allowed to do 2 moves in one time? No. But what if I really want, after I move this, if I really, really want to move this, and am I allowed to do it? No. Because in a game like chess, you have to wait until it's your turn. No matter how much I want to do it, I'm not allowed before you have moved and then I can do it. And then I have to wait for you. Also, if it takes a long time, I have to wait for you to move before I'm able to move. But this is not only in a game like chess and other games, it's like that. It's also in the real life. Because this is the same in the real life. We have sinned. God has sent his son Jesus to die for our sin. God has done everything he should do for his side. Now it's up to you. It's up to us. And God, he has done what he should, and now it's up to us, and he's waiting for you, for people to move. But the problem is that people are waiting for God. I've met so many people who said, if God is real, he needs to come to me. If God is real, he needs to come and show me. And I said to everybody of them, God is real, but he has done everything he should for his side. Now it's up to you to respond of it. You have sinned. God has sent his son Jesus to die from your sin. And he commands you and people all over the world to repent. And immediately you repent toward God, he will save you. He will do it immediately because he's waiting for you. He wants you to move so I can forgive you. And immediately you move, he forgives you. Immediately you get baptized, he sets you free from sin. Immediately you get lay your hands on people, you receive the Holy Spirit. So we have to do it. But we in the church somehow wait for God and want God to do it. And many non-Christians is also like that. So when I share the gospel to people, out on the street or inside a table like this, what I do out on the street, if I see people are open, I often invite them into McDonald's, Burger King, a cafe shop, something where I can sit down with them and share the gospel. And there I do like this. And I always start with this plain chest, because I want them to know that it's totally up to them. And then I said, now I want to show you how you shall move, what you need to do so God, he can forgive you. So I want to share the gospel the way I often share the gospel. Imagine this is God. God created man to live with God. Everything was good. They had fellowship. They were walking together. Everything was good at that time. You read it in the book of, in this, the beginning of the Bible. In Genesis, there was no sin in the world. There was no sickness. There was no depression. And people, Adam and Eve, walked with God. They talked with God. They knew him. But God created a lot of trees in the garden. And there was the tree of life. And when you eat of that, you're going to live forever. And you're not going to be sick. But there was also the tree of good and evil. Knowledge of good and evil. Why do God create a tree in the garden you are not allowed to eat of? Because he said you are allowed to eat of all the trees in the garden, but not that tree. Because God wanted to be real. My wife says she loved me, and I believe she loved me, because she in her own free will have chosen to be together with me. If she just did it because she was created to do it, or if she get a big check every month with a lot of money, she can look in my eyes and say, Tom, I love you, and I don't do it for money. But when it comes to the first, I need the money. I cannot surely know that she do it out of love, because he didn't have any choice. God wants to give people a choice. And people choose wrong. They eat of the tree of life. They eat of the tree of good and evil. And because of that, sin came into the world. Sin came into man. Man sinned against God, and he changed. Then God says, and you can read that in chapter 3, oh, if he don't want man to rise up, eat of the tree of life, because if they eat of the tree of life, they're going to live forever. And then we will always have problem with sin. So because he don't want people to eat of the tree of life, he throw them out of the garden, and he put angel to keep them away from the tree of life. And because of that, people didn't have fellowship with God anymore. And people got kids, and they sinned, and they got kicks, and they sinned, and they started to kill each other. And now we are living in this world where people are living in sin, far away from God, don't have fellowship with God. We are living in a falling world where there is sin, there is death, there is sickness, there is depression, there is war. And this world today is so different from the world God created. And I have met many people, also inside the church, who like, oh, I have difficulty believing God because of all the evil that happened out in the world. And I'm like, don't people read the Bible anymore? All the evil that's happened is the proof that the word is true. Because God is saying it's like that. Because we are living in a falling world. And we are not created to die. God didn't create man to die, but death came into the world through sin. And when everybody has sinned, you are going to die. When you sin, you are going to die. Because the wages of sin is death. And when you sin, you are going to die. And you don't want to die because there is something inside of us. Because we are not created to die. This is the world we are living in right now. The problem, as I told, is sin. But we don't see sin as a problem, because we have a problem. We compare ourselves to each other. Because if you are standing here in a falling world, and you compare yourself to this person there, this person there, this person there, you will think that you are okay. You will not see you as a bad person, and you will not see sin as sin really are, because you are comparing yourself to a fallen world. But if you compare yourself to God, and before sin came into the world, you will see how much you have fallen. And sin is much more than what we think it is. The Bible says you will not lie, and every liar is going to be thrown to hell. But we think, come on, lie is not so bad, because we put sin up in bad things and not so bad things and everything. But what we have to understand is not so much what we do, is who we do it to, against. If I lie to my daughter, she cannot do me anything. She's just 8 years old. But what if you lie to your wife? What can then happen? People today in the world is getting divorced because of that. What if you have a job and you lie to your boss? You can get fired. We are talking about the same thing. You may not lie. But if you lie to your daughter, nothing's going to happen. If you lie to a wife, you can get divorced or have a problem. If you lie to your boss, you can get fired. But what if you are in a court or lie to a judge? Then you can go to jail. Do you see that? You can go to jail because of a lie if you do it to a judge. Because you more authority the person have you sin against, your stronger judgment is there going to be. My daughter, nothing going to happen. My wife, problem. Job, you can get fired. Boss, you can get fired. Judge in a court, you can go to jail. Your more authority this person have, your stronger is the punishment going to be. But what you and we need to understand, that when we do sin, when you lie, when you do sin, you don't do it first or foremost to a person. You go do it to God, who have given you a life, who have created you. And God, His authority is so much greater than any judge here on earth. And because He's so much bigger, the punishment is so much stronger. And He's holy. And God, this is why Jesus said, He said, you may not kill. And many think, oh, I'm not killing anybody. But Jesus, go deeper, because it's not only what you do, it's only your thought life. He said, if you have hate in your heart, you're already a murderer. If you said idiot to somebody, you're going to go to hell, the Bible says. He also said, you may not look with lust on a woman. Because if you do that in your heart, you have already done idolatry with her, the same way as you physical have done it. Have you looked on porn on the internet? Have you been looking with lust on women? I know men, everybody have done it. I know of girls, people have done it, because we are living in this fallen world. But this is still sin, and God sees the same as if you actually go out and are unfaithful with somebody. Try to imagine, God is going to judge you out of His standard. Okay, let's give a sample. Imagine that I told you that when you got born, there was put a chip in your mind, and that chip has filmed every thought life, every deed you have done from when you got born until today. And I have got those video clips. And I have put a video together, 5 minutes video with the things you have done. Not all the good things, because when you do something wrong and come to a judge in a court, the judge in the court is not going to look at the good things. He don't care. He's just going to look at the crime. When God is going to look at your life, the crime in your life, what is going to happen? Imagine. I have that chip. I'm going to make a movie with you, 5 minutes, with all evil thoughts, deeds, with all the sin you have done, unclean thoughts, unclean things, the things you have done where you have closed the door, closed the light, and thought that nobody was seeing it. God is seeing everything. So what if I took that 5 minutes video clip with your life and put it on the internet? Put it on your Facebook. Put it out so everybody you know could see it. But you will be so ashamed that you are not going to show yourself any place again. I don't know what you would do with yourself. I don't know what I would do with myself. It was my life who was putting out on the internet. We will be so ashamed. Also, when we know that all the people around us is guilty the same way as you and me. So we here, if people truly know what was in us, we will be ashamed also if we know that everybody around us was guilty. But one day you are going to stand in front of a holy God who have never done those things you and me have done. And that day you are not going to say, it's not my fault. You're not going to open your mouth and give the fault to anybody else. You will fall down on your face as dead. You will know you are guilty, guilty, guilty. And God can throw every person to hell and still be a good God. Because the problem is not some, as some people say, how can a God throw good people to hell? If he do that, God is evil. No. It's not God that's a problem, it's people, it's man. We have sinned. And we have fallen so long from the standard that we don't see it anymore because we compare ourselves to each other. But God is a good God, the same as a good judge is going to take people who have done crime and put them to jail. God is going to punish sinners. And everybody have sinned. And if you deny that, you make God a liar. And if you are honest, you know you have sinned. So this is the problem today. Sin came to the world. If God won, he could throw the whole world to hell. And he will still be a good judge. He could throw everybody who have done sin to hell and be a good God. Because the problem is you have sinned. But God, he don't want us. He loved us. So he sinned. He loved us. So he sent his son, Jesus Christ. Jesus was born by God, the Son of God. He is God. He lived a life here without ever sinning. He didn't steal. He didn't lie. He kept God's commandment. He did everything God commanded him to. He never sinned. He walked with God like Adam before sin came to the world. And he lived a perfect life. When he was 13 years old, he got baptized with the Holy Spirit. And from that day on, he started to walk around and say, the kingdom of God is near. He was preaching the good news and he was healing everybody who was sick and bound by Satan because God was with him. And he walked here and did miracles. He died on a cross. But because he have never lied like you and me, never stolen like you and me, never done the things we have done, then he rose up again. When he got buried, he rose up again. And he came to his disciples, talked to them about the kingdom, and went to heaven and sent his Holy Spirit down here. This is what Jesus did. And now we need to believe in him. And we need to do the things the Bible says, repent from our sins, get baptized in water, and receive the Holy Spirit. So what is a disciple? What is a Christian? It's somebody who recognizes their sin. I have sinned against God. And they repent toward God and believe in Jesus. And when you do that, God is going to remove the stone heart and give you a new heart. The new life is going to come inside of you. But you need to bury the old body. The body is dead. The spirit is alive. So you need to bury the body. How do you do that? You do that by getting baptized in water. And this is so important, like in countries where there is many people die because of tsunami or earthquake and other things. They very fast bury the dead people. Because if a dead person is not getting buried, the body is going to rotten. And that body is going to create sickness and it's going to kill the life there is. So it's so important that the life inside of you is not going to get killed, that you bury the old body. And you do that by dying with Christ and you are coming up again. And then you receive in the Holy Spirit. And see, this is the same Holy Spirit that is in Christ. You don't receive a small Holy Spirit and he have a big Holy Spirit. No, the same Holy Spirit. And now you are walking here on earth in Christ's place. free from sin, baptized with the Holy Spirit, and going around and preaching the good news and healing the sick the same way as Jesus did it. And when people believe your word about Jesus, then they repent toward God from their sin. They get baptized and to Jesus Christ, and then they receive the Holy Spirit and start to walk here on earth in Christ's place. So this is what you need to do to get saved. You have to repent from your sin, you have to get baptized in water, and you have to receive the Holy Spirit. And then if you continue in Christ, one day, the Bible says, in the last chapter of the Bible, you're going to stand, put up your hand, and eat of the tree of life in the New Jerusalem. And this is what it's all about. It's all about the tree of life. Sin came into the world, so people were thrown out of the garden, so they could not eat of the tree of life. And sin was the problem. Then God started to, he tried to create a new heaven, a new earth with the flood, with Noah. But, and put Noah and his family in it. But the problem was that sin was in them. They have sinned. So this time, instead of starting creating a new earth, he started to create a new man, a new woman. And out of that, he's later going to create a new earth. And when you are new in Christ, you are walking here. He's working in your life with sin, cleansing you. And we try to look like Jesus, but one day, when we step over the last step, we're going to look exactly like him. And there, we're going to take out the and eat of the tree of life and live forever. So do I believe in once saved, always saved? Yes. But we are first once saved, really saved, when we are there. Take the hand and eat of the tree of life you read about in the last chapter in the Bible. Who is the tree of life? The tree of life is Jesus. Jesus is the tree of life. We can eat of him now. We can be part of him now. And when we have the Holy Spirit, we have the guarantee of our salvation. And we continue walking in him by the Holy Spirit. And one day we are going to stand in front of him. This is how I share the gospel, something like that. And then when I have shared the gospel, I said to people, you have to repent. And then I take them hand and I pray for them. And if they from their heart repent toward God, the Holy Spirit is going to touch them and fill them up. And then say, let's pray for the baptism and the Holy Spirit. I pray one more time. And they get baptized with the Holy Spirit to talk and start to speak in tongues. And then I go out and baptize them in water. And then I kickstart them the same day. I have done this many, many times. And I believe we need to share the gospel so people understand what they need to do. And you cannot do that 5 minutes just out on the street. You have to take time with people and do it. Maybe a half hour, maybe 20 minutes. But share the gospel and then pray for them. Get them baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then take them out, find some water, get them baptized by water, in water to Jesus Christ, and then start to disciple them. This is what Jesus has commanded us. Go out baptizing people in the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and then teach them to obey everything I have commanded. And he is with us to the end of the world. And one day we are going to see him as he is. When we are going to come out of this body, we are going to see him as he is. This is how I share the gospel. Are you not saved? Have you only started to get saved by repenting? You need to get baptized in water. Have you not received the Holy Spirit? You need to go and get baptized with the Holy Spirit. Find somebody who have it, who can pray for you, or see God pray, because God says if you pray, he's going to give you the Holy Spirit. This is a promise. So this is the teaching I'm going to share this time. If you have Christian, come with a Christian, because next time I'm going to talk about repentance and sin, and then I'm going to talk about baptism water, and then I'm going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And then we are going to continue talk about Luke 10. And I look so much forward because all of this teaching is just the beginning. I'm continue building on when we come to Luke 10, where I'm going to show you the vision Jesus has given us as the body of Christ and how we are going to help him build his church. But God bless you with this teaching. And I hope that this is going to be a blessing for you. And see the teaching again and again. Show it, sit at home, practice how you share the gospel. So when you are standing in front of somebody, you know how to do it. God bless you.